How are we doing? Welcome to the first Friday forum of the semester, and it's also our Constitution Day program. We're really pleased to have with us two speakers who are going to share some of their experiences clerking for federal court judge here in the Southern District of Mississippi, Carlton Reeves. Before I introduce them, let me welcome you to Millsaps for those who are visiting the campus. My name is Kenneth Townsend, and I wear a few different hats here at the college. Related to today's program, I teach constitutional law, civil liberties, and civil rights, so I'm particularly excited to experience the conversation up here today. My role in the conversation is designed to be very minimal. I might ask a question or two to kind of get things started, but it's mostly an opportunity for us to hear from our speakers. We're going to leave some time at the end for audience Q&A, so I hope you'll be thinking of some questions to ask our panelists towards the end of our time together. So also, I want to take a quick note, since this is our first Friday forum of the semester, to let y'all know that most Fridays throughout the semester, we will have programs at 1 p.m. here in this room. So I hope you can come back in future weeks. Next week, we have a panel discussion called This Is How You're a Citizen, and it will focus on the freshman reading assignment that some of you have undertaken in recent weeks and months, Citizen by Claudia Rankin. And Anita DeRong will moderate a panel that will include Ralph Eubanks, C. Lee McGinnis, and Adria Walker, a student here at Millsaps. So I hope you can join that as well. And you can easily find the full schedule on our website. Okay? So without any further logistical matters, let me go ahead and transition to the introductions of today's speakers. Okay, so we have with us, I think I've got all this memorized, but I've jotted down some notes in case I need to cheat. But we have immediately to my left, we have Alicia Netterville. And Alicia is originally from Gulfport, Mississippi, and is a graduate of USM, Jackson State, and the University of Mississippi School of Law. So. She's a very educated woman. She also had a fair bit of experience in different contexts in state government, lobbying, and a variety of different fields before going back to law school. She graduated law school in 2015 and started clerking for Judge Reeves thereafter and has just wrapped up her clerkship with Judge Reeves. Immediately to Alicia's left is Alyssa Johnson. Alyssa is originally from Lexington, Kentucky. And she has been in Mississippi for, I think she said, about 5 years now, and works at the Southern one thing I didn't add about Alicia, I need to come back to that. She is about to start at Bradley, formerly Bradley A. Randolph Cummins downtown, an excellent law firm here in Jackson. Alyssa works at Southern Poverty Law Center here in Jackson, and is a graduate of Loyola University in Chicago School of Law, where she received her Master's in Social Work along with her JD, and worked at SPLC for a few years before clerking, clerked this past year with Judge Reeves, and also just finished that clerkship at the same time as Alicia. We're really thrilled to have both of them with us here today. I've been corresponding with them over email over the last few weeks. We just had lunch together, and they're delightful folks, and I know they're going to provide some interesting insights during our time together today. So, without anything more from me, I'm going to ask them a question. I'm going to turn on the microphone and sit down. Does this work? Test? All right, there we go. So, one of the questions that we talked a little bit about beforehand that we thought might be an interesting way to get the conversation started is, what do you think is the most underappreciated amendment of the United States Constitution? And I'm going to go ahead and hand it on over to Alicia, and she's going to get us started.
Good afternoon, everyone. As far as the most underappreciated amendment to the Constitution, I'm using the word underappreciated in the understanding of the text and the impact that the amendment actually has. And in my opinion, the most underappreciated amendment to the Constitution is the 13th Amendment. The very text of the 13th Amendment is often overlooked. Most times people look at the 13th Amendment and say that the 13th Amendment abolished slavery, which is true. It did abolish slavery and involuntary servitude. The most underappreciated clause of the amendment is except for the punishment of a crime. So while slaves were freed by the 13th Amendment, They were also, newly freed slaves were also subjected to being made petty criminals in order to return back to the same system of slavery from which they were freed under the 13th Amendment. Here in Mississippi, it allowed Black Code, a different slavery, just by another name. And more recently, if you've ever heard of Michelle Alexander and her book, The New Jim Crow, I believe she does shed light on the fact that the 13th Amendment paved the way for what we currently have today as prison slavery. And there was one instance that comes to mind in a Louisiana prison where a private corporation contracted with the private prison to make cleaning supplies and uniforms for the prisoners. And it was intended to be a pre-release program so that prison could operate the way that it is supposed to rehabilitate individuals and to prepare them to return to society. But in fact, what was revealed was that people who had 20 years, 30 years, were actually working for little on the dollar to make this corporation's uniforms and supplies, when it was intended for people who had 1 year or less so that they could be productive citizens when they returned to society. And that's perfectly legal under the 13th Amendment and under the text of the 13th Amendment. And I also believe that it's very underappreciated because slavery by any other name is still slavery. And there was an amendment offered before the amendment was passed to amend the language to just abolish slavery nationally and permanently. But of course that amendment didn't pass, so that's why we have the except language. And it's very underappreciated because we rarely see it litigated in court. I recently read an article where some people are using it for violations of human trafficking when people are used as slaves for labor or sex trafficking. People have raised the 13th Amendment. And I'll pass the mic to Alyssa right now, and she can expound on a case that she has read about where a prisoner actually did invoke the 13th Amendment.
Good afternoon, everybody. Before I talk about the case Alicia referenced, at SPLC I've done some prison litigation, and I think it's really important to build on what Alicia said about the 13th Amendment and this accept clause that allows for prisoners, because what it is set up a new system. And we see the system 150 years later, we see how we haven't even been able to dismantle this accept clause. When you think about the fact that here in Mississippi, the state penitentiary, and for those of you that don't know, used to be where the current state capitol is. And it was relocated, the state penitentiary was relocated to Parchman right around the turn of the century. And for those of you all who I'm sure have seen pictures of Parchman or heard about Parchman, although it is downsized now, at its peak, so to speak, all it was a plantation. That's what it was. It was, to some extent, it was self-surviving and self-sufficient and possibly could have taught folks who were incarcerated agricultural skills and business skills, but that is not what it was. What it became and what it continues to be is very much the model of a plantation that we all have read about throughout the South. I think that when you think about that, at the point the 13th Amendment was passed, we allowed this exception, said a lot about what this country thought of folks who were convicted of crimes, and I think that that rhetoric has not yet changed when we talk about prisoners and we talk about what they're entitled to. And the reality is, if we can force somebody to work for nothing, it does say a lot about society, what we think of their humanity. Because 150 years ago, before the Civil War, before the passage of the 13th Amendment, when that was permitted throughout the country, it would be difficult to challenge what we thought, what this country as a society thought of a class of people. The case Alicia spoke of that I came across in getting ready for today, and I apologize I don't have more details, but I thought it was interesting that the 13th Amendment has been challenged in the sense of pre-trial detainees. So folks who have not yet been convicted but are being held in jail, being forced to work either within the facility, or as you know, sometimes you might see folks doing kind of grounds work around your city and county buildings, or working for a company. So there are opportunities to look at how we think about constitutional amendments, and that they do not stay in the time in which they were passed, right? That they were, you know, I think Alicia and I agree that the Constitution is very much a living document, and that if we stayed, you know, when the Constitution became the law of the land, if it had never been challenged, if its limits had never been pushed, Alicia and I would probably not be sitting here before you as lawyers. and so that's something that we have to think about as we think about laws and society and the values of our system, and that, you know, yes, sometimes new laws are required, but sometimes we just need to take a closer look at what we have on the books and how to creatively and strategically challenge the status quo.
So, building off this point that you just made about the Constitution being a living document, I'm interested if there are ways in which you feel like particular amendments have evolved over time, their public meaning have perhaps evolved over time, if you'd like to reflect on that.
As a listener, we're talking, I made the statement to her that I don't understand how anybody can really be a textualist when you look at the history of the evolution of our amendments, in particular the 14th Amendment. So going back to one of the things that's underappreciated about the 14th Amendment is the 14th Amendment had to clarify to southern states like Mississippi that the 13th Amendment also means that freed slaves are citizens with rights and privileges of everyone else. And even though the 14th Amendment was originally intended to clarify the status of African Americans, it has expanded to provide rights to many people who have been discriminated against and oppressed in our country. The LGBT community, for example, those cases are brought under the 14th Amendment Equal Protection Clause. People with disabilities, we've seen that amendment in my time grow more than any other amendment, as well as the First Amendment. The First Amendment, I'm a Christian. I am very appreciative of the First Amendment allowing me the right to exercise my religion in this country, but also it has grown to allow other people the right to exercise their religion in this country. So the evolution of the amendments are proof positive that we have a living document that changes with time, and more so for the better than for the worse.
In terms of amendments that have evolved, I was thinking about the 8th Amendment, which is the right to not be subjected to cruel and unusual punishment. And strictly within, when you think about the fact that 30 or 40 years ago, we executed children. we executed people who had cognitive disabilities. And so to think that it took challenges to that amendment, right? It wasn't until the 90s that Roper was decided and we no longer executed children. And I think for many of us in this room, the idea that a child can be executed seems to kind of like, is striking with what we know about children, what we know about adolescent development, and how we treat children in so many other spaces of our society. But there was a time and a place in this country where people thought that was acceptable. And once we eliminated the death penalty, now, you know, the next fight has been the elimination of life without parole for kids who did not commit murder. And then even for those who have committed a homicide crime, that there's some consideration, that it's not automatic, it cannot be automatic. And thinking of Atkins cases, which was the Supreme Court case that abolished the death penalty for those who fall below a specific cognitive threshold. And to think that at a time in the not very recent past, we executed folks who didn't completely or could not completely appreciate their crime and their conduct and be held accountable, and we thought that they had committed the crime was enough without further looking into the mitigation, into the circumstances, into their unique characteristics warranted the death penalty. And so I'm intrigued. A lot of these issues are near and dear to my heart, and I spend my professional life working on some of them, is where we're going to go from here, right? To think that, you know, for a lot of you all in this room that are in college, right? When you're 40, what will be, like, where will some of these issues be? Where will things have gone? What will, you know, the fights that are being had now around the country, the academic discourse that you all are having here that will hopefully lead you all into the community and into impacting change, what will that look like? And will it be something that we can imagine now? You know, you wonder if in the 50s or 60s or 70s, folks thought that we would abolish and limit the death penalty the way we have, or that we would no longer subject children to automatic life without the possibility of parole. And so, you know, sometimes we don't have all the ideas yet, but just the evolution of the amendments and how they grow and the way that they were written that allows the interpretation is very interesting to see.
So this was not a question that we discussed in advance, but building upon what you just said, if you were to make guesses yourselves about 40 years from now, what are we going to look back on and say, can y'all believe that in 2016 we did X, Y, Z, or that this amendment was interpreted this way? If you were to make projections out 40 years from now, is there anything that does immediately come to mind? And I'm putting you on the spot to some extent, but you kind of brought it up, so I feel like it's kind of weird. And if nothing does immediately come to mind, then maybe we can circle back later in our time together.
I mean, I guess I hope that we continue to consider and erode away at the death penalty, or personally, those are my own views, and that we continue to look at the rights of people and specifically vulnerable populations. I think in its true spirit to me, the Constitution absolutely was intended for all, but in its intention for all, I hope to some extent that it had a recognition that it was necessary because all people were not viewed and treated equally at the time it was created and even now. And so that it is a document that as we continue to strive towards that goal, that, you know, the 14th Amendment and even in the way in which other amendments and other constitutional ideas hit at it, that there is this goal of equality and justice.
As far as what I think I would be looking back at and saying, oh, I can't believe that we were doing that in 2016, is the interpretation of the ordinary meaning of cruel in the Eighth Amendment. People have said that, oh, it's not cruel to have someone in a prison when it's 100 degrees because we have ice with fans blowing on them. So that's not cruel treatment. So in terms of the evolution of even a word in an amendment would be something that I would look back to see if the interpretation of that word has changed judicially, or just even in the hearts and minds of people, have those interpretations changed and what they think about those. As far as the 14th Amendment, I think that looking back, I will see that the 14th Amendment will continue to evolve. I think that equal protection will continue to evolve for wider groups and wider rights. More substantive rights under the 14th Amendment, I think we'll see in times to come as well.
So much of what we've been discussing over the last few minutes concerning the 8th and 14th Amendment seems to be a story of progress in a way, that we have maybe become more enlightened, that we've done things better. I'm wondering if it's that simple. I wonder if there are maybe other amendments in the Constitution that have maybe come to be interpreted in different ways, but not necessarily for the better, right? Because constitutional interpretation changes over time. I think it might be a little naive to assume that change is always in becoming more enlightened direction. And I'm wondering if there are examples that come to mind for y'all, or maybe 50 years ago, or maybe 100 years ago, or maybe 20 years ago, we did it better, and we've kind of we've fallen back in some negative direction.
This may or may not really answer your question, but I'm going to take a point of personal privilege and say that there, I think as we move forward as a society and talk about technology and constitutional amendments and primarily the Fourth Amendment, which I think my co-panelists will agree with this line of discussion. You know, the Supreme Court in the last three or four terms has had a case almost each term that looked at the intrusion upon our personal rights, whether it's with drones or tracking devices on a car, all of these things, you know, our cell phones, you know, that by and large we are all attached to a computer and a tracking device, right? That you look up something on Google and then you get on your other social media and it's advertising, you know, that clothing store or that restaurant to you. And so when we think about 50 and 60 years ago, that when we thought about search and seizure and some of the bedrock case law that established those baselines could not have contemplated, that we couldn't have contemplated where we are technologically. And I think that is, that's why we have to keep, you know, the idea of the Fourth Amendment was to protect us and to keep the government away, and that if you, you know, for to that level of intrusion, you need to have probable cause, you need to have a search warrant. And I think we see, in so many contexts where that's because of the ease of information nowadays, that is being, there's some holes possibly being poked into that.
Yes, I definitely agree. Actually, the reason she's saying that is because I wrote a paper for my civil rights class in law school on Fourth Amendment implications of domestic drone use in high crime neighborhoods. If you look at neighborhoods like South Side and West Side of Chicago, they have these districts where there are stationary cameras on poles. And that's only limited to people who are in the purview of the camera, who are coming into contact with the camera. Well, I was doing research one day on the use of drones and realized that police departments can actually get permits to conduct searches if somebody breaks out of prison, and they can do searches. And I look at all of the evolution of the Fourth Amendment as a slippery slope, because if they can do a search, a wide range search, and a police department can get a permit or a certificate to surveil a high crime neighborhood because they suspect someone in that neighborhood is a criminal or a fugitive, they can surveil the entire community. And so in surveilling, in defining what a high crime community is, it's at the discretion of the police departments. And I don't think anybody will argue that the South Side and West Side of Chicago would be considered a high crime community by any police department. So what would happen and what that would look like is we have drones the size of, smaller than this microphone, flying around neighborhoods every day, all day. And it's just a matter of me passing Kenneth something in a high crime neighborhood at a particular time at night that makes it look suspicious. And that would be enough to give probable cause for foot patrol to be alerted by the drone and to come and search me or search Kenneth or even arrest us. Also, Fourth Amendment, I think what a lot of people don't understand about the Fourth Amendment is that it's a public responsibility to establish our expectation of privacy. When we started flying in airplanes, we determined that we were willing to give up an expectation of privacy of a portion of our airspace. So the more technology that we accept, the more of those apps that we allow to look at everything on our phone, the more we allow 7-Eleven to deliver us Slurpees by drone. That's the new thing. Amazon was not given a license to use it at first when they first applied, but now if they can deliver within 30 minutes of your home, then they can deliver your packages by drone. So we are, as a society, saying, okay, I accept a lower expectation of privacy in my airspace by having drones become a regular part of our airspace. And it's going to be even lower than an airplane, so we probably will see a time when we don't have any expectation of privacy of our airspace over our homes.
Very interesting commentary. So yesterday, some of you may have filled out, may have written on this poster board that we had posted outside of the cafeteria, is that if you could propose a constitutional amendment, what would it be? The Politics of Government Club sponsored that. Any of you here who are involved with that, thank you. for your efforts. And we got a number of interesting proposed constitutional amendments written on that poster board. I'm not going to get into all those now, but I mentioned that to provide an opportunity to ask y'all. Again, I'm kind of putting you on the spot. This is not a question we cleared in advance. Y'all are going to hate me before the time's over. But I'm wondering if there are things that you have in mind, like in your ideal world, if you could snap your fingers and pass a constitutional amendment. Of course, it's kind of a complicated process, and I'm not sure that anything is going to be added to the Constitution anytime soon. But if that were possible, what might be your new constitutional amendment? Does anything come to mind? If not, we can also come back to this later.
I don't have an immediate one, but I think as you were asking the question and thinking about, you know, what's on the table, right? To be a constitutional amendment, my mind shifted from federal to state, because there's so many rights that states retain, and that sometimes we forget that the state constitution is a huge source of power and a huge source. You know, if we look at just Mississippi's constitution, and one of the ways in which it differs from other state constitutions is many other states have a right to education in their constitution in a way that Mississippi does not. And so when you think, you know, I think when we get into these constitutional conversations, we have to also bring it back to think about on a more local level, at the state level, what are we doing? Because so much of our federal constitution says, here, states, like, we're recognizing your power and your authority. So I think that if I could have a constitutional amendment, it might be a state amendment. I mean, education is an important issue. I'm not exactly sure what it would be, but I think that there's a unique opportunity to really impact citizens at a more direct level that way.
Keeping with Alyssa's opinion on the state level, when I did my lobbying work, I lobbied against the what's called the payday lending industry, the predatory payday loan industry. And one of the biggest challenges that we had, and one of the most successes that we saw in other states, was that there was a rate cap in their state constitution. So Arkansas, for example, they're capped at 17%. APR because it was in their constitution. So my constitutional amendment would be to set a rate cap on all consumer lending products in the state.
All right, so let's transition a little bit to speak more about your experiences as a clerk and how that you feel is preparing you for the next phase of your career. I'm wondering if you can reflect a little bit on the value of the clerkship experience. I know you just wrapped up in recent weeks, so in some ways you're probably still learning all the value of how it's going to translate into your work post-clerkship. But what is it that you feel like the clerkship will provide you as you move on into your career?
As for me, the clerking was, I think, most valuable to me because I have not practiced law, unlike Alyssa, so I'm about to start practicing law next month. And having the experience of learning my audience at the court and who I'm writing to at the court is, I think, will prove very invaluable. You're writing to the judge, but also you're writing to his clerks. So we're usually the first ones to read the briefs. If a brief is too long, we have to read it, but we may not be excited about it. If a brief is not clear and concise, are we gonna understand what the parties are trying to say? So knowing that my audience is the clerk who has a docket that they have to work through, and knowing that my writing needs to be clear, concise, and to the point, is, I think, going to prove invaluable for my experience practicing law. Also knowing the inner workings of the court and how decisions are made, I've been able to look at procedure from the beginning of a case to the end of a case without actually having to do it, and learn different styles of litigation from the plaintiff side as well as from the defense side. I'll be doing civil defense. So I was able to actually take a back seat and be a spectator and look at how people write, how people act timely, I learned that a lot of times if you work with the court will work with you on deadlines and just having a good relationship with the court, with the clerks, and with the judge is very invaluable. And had I not clerked, I don't think I would have been told that information, but I would know it firsthand and how it works in practice.
Similar to Alicia, I think one of the values from clerking that I will see in practice as I re-enter is, you know, prior to clerking, I worked for about 4 years, various types of litigation, mostly in federal court. And the litigation I worked on, I was familiar with. It was almost organic to me because I was meeting with clients, I was doing the research, I was working up the case, you know, communicating with opposing counsel. I mean, all of this back and forth. And I realized when I got to the court, when the court picks up an issue, it picks it up, I mean, almost at the end. And I think that was a very different, just in terms of reading a case, you know, looking at the complaint, the answer to the complaint, maybe whatever motion is before the court to decide, it's already packaged, which in some ways is nice for you, but in some ways it's almost like this catch-up. And it made me think about my writing style and how you have to write, you know, in Mississippi, I think on average federal judges have, you know, 200 something cases, right? If you think about how many, there's no way that they can even, you know, a judge that is reading as much as possible and paying close attention, which all the judges are doing, can keep up with that much information and the minutia and details that when you're practicing and even thinking like from your all's perspective as students, right? When you write a paper, there's so much that you're like, of course they know that because you know it in your mind, but you haven't put it into paper. And so I think clerking for me was a really good reminder of just communicating more effectively and making sure the facts and details as I lay them out are helping me in terms of written argument and oral argument to be persuasive and to be more impactful for my clients.
So of the students in here, how many of you are contemplating maybe going to law school? So for the students in here who are contemplating going to law school, I'm wondering, Alicia and Alyssa, what ideas or suggestions you might have for them at this point in their careers as undergraduates, what do they need to be thinking about as they contemplate whether or not to go to law school and to become lawyers?
My story is a little different because I always planned to go to law school. Undergraduate, I majored in English and paralegal studies. And I had a plan to go to law school, but I got a master's in public policy and administration and decided to put off law school for a career to write public policy for the state of Mississippi. And then I became a lobbyist, and then I did community and economic development work. So I could speak to those who, because I really don't remember what I know I was focused on my grades. I knew I wanted to stay in Mississippi, so I knew that it would be one of the two Mississippi law schools. I know I was focused on studying for the LSAT and doing very well on that. But for those of you who are not planning on going directly to law school, I would encourage you that law school is never too late to go to law school. This is truly a second career for me. And all of the experiences that I have, that I had in policy and economic development, community development, really helped me in law school. So if you're going to be or planning on being a non-traditional law student, the things that I would recommend that you focus on are being involved in your community, networking with people in the legal profession. If you're going into different careers, try to focus on things that will have you engrossed in policy issues, legislative issues, community issues. And also remember that if you plan on staying in Mississippi, that Ole Miss and MC are right here. You have a wealth of knowledge in the attorneys. You have alumni that went to these law schools, and you also have the courts. And you can go to the courts and you can sit in on court proceedings. You can talk to judges. You can get advice from judges. In particular, I can speak personally for Judge Reeves. He loves to communicate with students who are preparing to go to law school. So that's another connection. and another resource to prepare for law school is just to go and sit in and see how the proceedings work and send an email to the chambers and ask Judge Reeves if you can sit down and talk with him and if he has any recommendations.
I would agree with everything Alicia said. I went straight to law school from undergrad. I worried that if I took a break, I wouldn't find motivation again. And I think part of it is just availing yourselves of the opportunities inside the classroom and outside of the classroom, whether it's working, interning, being part of the community, whether it's your campus community and the community at large. In terms of, you know, I knew the type of law I wanted to practice well before I started law school, but you don't have to. So I sometimes talk to students who thinking about law school but don't know what kind of law they want to practice. That's fine. You shouldn't. You don't have to. So don't be like dissuaded by that of feeling like you need to have it all figured out of, oh, I know for sure I want to be this kind of lawyer and I want to do this kind of work, because you should be open to the evolution, right? There's a lot of work that I've done. If you'd have asked me 5 or 6 years ago if I wanted to do it or intended to do it, I'd been like, maybe not as much. But there's a lot of room to grow, and if you find your issue, you know, find issues and things that you're passionate about, you know, there are lawyers who love to litigate, right? They love to be in a courtroom, but aren't necessarily as particular about the subject matter that they are in the courtroom arguing, right? They just want to be a litigator. There are lawyers who never want to step foot in a courtroom and do not step foot in a courtroom. I have friends that went to law school that practice purely transactional work, which is primarily contracts. if there becomes a dispute that has to go to a courtroom, they call one of the lawyers who does litigation. And then I have friends who went to law school and did a whole host of other things, whether it's related to working at a law firm on like discovery and litigation support issues, teaching. I mean, there's a variety, lobbying. I would say that when I started practicing law, I didn't expect to really like the policy work as much as I have enjoyed over the last several years, and really, you know, digging into that and seeing the impact that can make. So I think as you all look at programs, look for strong writing programs, programs that have moot court programs, good journals, things of that, because picking your law school should be about more than just the classroom you're going to be in, because it's all of those other experiences that'll help you make connections in order to have, you know, find a job outside of law school, meet people that kind of share similar interests in that nature.
Great, we're about to hand it over and give y'all a chance to weigh in, but before we do that, I want to ask, one last question, and that is, maybe it's a multi-part question. Who is your favorite Supreme Court justice of all time? And who is your favorite Supreme Court justice who's currently on the court? If you don't want to answer both, you can pick one. Or if you don't want to answer any of those, your least favorite Supreme Court justice of all time or of the current court?
Personally, I don't really have a favorite justice. I appreciate the differences, the varieties on the court. Some of them I agree with strongly, some of them I disagree with strongly, but it's that variety in looking at the different opinions, not just the majority opinion, but also the dissent, that helps you sharpen your skills on looking at the Constitution and developing your own ideas about interpretation and what it should mean and what the Constitution and the amendments really stand for. So, although my views are more on the liberal end, as far as the Constitution evolving and being a living document, I do appreciate the opinions and the dissents of the more textualist justices on the court.
Yeah, I can't really say I have a favorite, but I do agree that even sometimes when I really agree with the majority opinion, but there is a dissent, I read the dissent, because just from one perspective, that's how you become a better, you know, a better litigator, a better lawyer, is appreciating the variety of arguments that can be made, and that if you look at not just Supreme Court precedent, but precedent at any level, that sometimes the minority opinion later becomes the majority opinion as we shift. And so I think that the role the judiciary plays at the federal level, especially because there's a lot more writing, whether it's district court, circuit court, which is the appellate court in the federal system, and then the Supreme Court, is just that I think the judges in the federal judiciary truly, many of them truly kind of take on this role of not just ruling on the order or the issue itself, but taking the time to educate the public and speak to the public as an appreciation that the orders that come from from all of the federal courts are read and distributed broadly. And so it's not just about the answer to the question is, yes or no, or the motion is granted or denied, but I think that there's a lot of thoughtful writing and viewpoint as to how to craftily make an argument and explain the opinion, not for justification purposes, but to help the public understand, especially when you get to these issues that are more constitutional and personal in nature, or social justice or civil rights and civil liberties. Yes, a judge could very easily say, this is the right, but then we'd all be like, but why? and when you think of the opinions and the cases that I'm sure some of you all know or are familiar with, it's not just the answer that probably resonates or that you recall, it's the why and the reasoning. And so I think that's just, I guess it's part of the reason I love the law.
Yeah, I think that's a beautiful way to wrap up this portion of the program. And it's a plug, I think, for all of those who are trying to decide what classes to take for the spring. I'll let you know that we can explore this further in my Civil Liberties and Civil Rights class, Tuesday, Thursday mornings next semester. hope to see all of you there. So now I think for the remainder of our program, it would be nice to bring in the audience, to give you all a chance to participate in this conversation. I hope you've been thinking about or maybe writing down some questions during our time together. I see Elise raise her hand, so Elise, if we need to pass along a microphone, we can, but I bet y'all can be heard.
Yeah, first of all, I just
want to
say what an interesting program it was. My mind is full of all kinds of questions, but I wanted to go back to something that was first talked about this issue of payment for prisoners, which I'm embarrassed to say that I hadn't really thought about before. And my mind was thinking about the fact that, of course, prisoner rights are curtailed in various ways because of criminal charges brought against them. They're in prison. There are a lot of things that they no longer have freedom to do. And so I wondered if you could help me a little bit more with this issue of why they would be paid, and then the question of how much they would be paid. Would they be paid the same amount as anybody else who might be working on a similar farm outside of the prison context? Would they be minimum wage that would be appropriate for prison labor?
Well, currently, and it varies greatly by state and system. But typically, prisoners like working in a state prison are getting paid cents on the dollar, 20 cents an hour, something like that. There are some, and I only know this from sitting in on a hearing at the state capitol, that there are some industries, because they're governed by federal law, that to hire a prison industry or and employ prisoners, you have to pay the federal wage, whatever that is, but it's a very small number of types of jobs, and they're usually a little more advanced in skill. It's not enough that you could support, even if you did not have family, right, and you're saying, I'm gonna get a job so that I can put money in my commissary, I can buy envelopes, I can make phone calls. You will not be able to do that in any meaningful way on, by and large, what we pay prisoners. Your comments, though, actually made me realize that if I was to make a constitutional amendment, what it would be, and it would be to restore voting rights to everybody. That would be it, because I think that when we look at this, when we look at the power of voting and the fact that folks that go through the criminal justice system because they can't vote aren't on juries and are eliminated from other parts of the civil process, and the impact that has on our society and the perspectives and the viewpoints that are present and part of the conversations. I know yesterday I read an article that the Virginia Supreme Court agreed with the Virginia governor who had acted individually to restore voting rights to about 20,000 people, and a group of folks challenged his right to do that, and the Virginia Supreme Court agreed with the governor that he had the right to restore those voting acts through, I believe, his executive power. And so I would say that once folks finish their sentences, arguably I would say even while they're incarcerated, but I could maybe be swayed, but probably not too much, that that the right to vote should be viewed as much more fundamental than we currently do.
Yeah, and for those, I guess in a number of you are aware of this already, but in a number of states, after committing certain types of crimes, often felony crimes, you lose your right to vote, and not just while you're in prison, but for the rest of your life. Some states allow you to regain the right to vote after finishing your sentence, but Alyssa would like to see a constitutional amendment that guarantees that right upon finishing your sentence at the very least.
Yeah.
Good. All right, next question.
Ben. Purely a friendly comment, but for the students that maybe contemplating law school, there are folks within the sort of textualist and originalist camp that certainly share sympathies and go in the sort of progressive directions that the living constitutionalists go as well. So if you find yourself in that camp and you find the text compelling, but those folks are out there too.
Spoken like a student of a Bill Maher. Ben and I went to the same law school and had the same professor, and he is one example of a professor who, exactly, his method seems to be a more conservative sort of method, but he reaches more seemingly liberal conclusions. Thanks, Ben. Teresa, were you going to ask a question?
Well, yes, and I feel like, when they say there's no stupid question, I kind of feel like that, because in this camp, I'm not a student of law. I have a lot of passions, and I think most people are like me, they have a lot of feeling, but not a lot of education. So, how do you speak to things like, even to ask the question, what constitutional amendment would you suggest? What should be your background thinking to answer that kind of question? So what is important in considering how you should change or recommend for the Constitution, or how you should evaluate an issue in relation to the Constitution?
That's an interesting question. In some ways, it builds a little bit upon your last comment, Alyssa, about the role of the judge in providing kind of almost a public education in the law. Who wants to take a stab at this question?
Before I had a background in the law, which my background is still minimal because I haven't practiced yet, but a clerk with Judge Reeves exposed me to a lot of different areas of the law. But even before going to law school, or even before working in public policy, I was able to, as a member of society, be observant of what I felt was right and wrong, and how the law played a part in that. So you don't necessarily have to be a legal scholar or exposed to the law enough to know I rarely recommend that anybody get their information from mainstream news. But just society, people that you know, talking to people that, since we've been talking about incarceration, I'll just use that for an example, about people who may have been incarcerated and did not get proper legal representation. Issues like that. The issue of predatory lending was on my mind way before I knew what the law behind it was about, or that our legislature had actually passed legislation to allow this predatory lending. I saw the effects in the community just by being involved in the community. So you do not have to be a legal scholar or exposed to the law to fight for justice. If you think that the law is not right, or that something is not working, the law is not working the way that it is supposed to work, to go to your representatives or senators and to be an active part in your community to change the laws. So you should never feel inadequate to play a role in changing our state constitution or federal constitution and the laws that impact us every day as citizens.
Yeah, I would agree. I mean, the cases that have been most impactful and changed our society were brought by individuals that had a problem that the law was not being applied equally or fairly or justly to them or to the, you know, to the circumstances. And so I think that is it. It's like that the people know what's working and what's not. And that, you know, in thinking of it from a policy perspective, I think very often when you go to your elected officials, you know, they have kind of a macro level view. And what I think citizens offer is the micro perspective that is so needed in policy reform, right? If, you know, if I say, oh, I want to make this change in policy, but I have no consideration of how it's going to affect the individual, how it's going to be applied, the potential unintended consequences of enacting such a policy, then I'm missing the very goal that I say, you know, that I'm out to rectify. And so I think that's why you don't need the legal background, the legal education, just the stories and kind of recognizing where things don't seem right and don't seem fair, and asking questions and asking the folks that have that education background and that expertise in a way, whether it's in politics and government and the like, to say, hey, this is the problem, and I'm not sure yet of exactly the solution, but it doesn't seem like it should stay this way.
Well, so let me ask a follow-up question. So this is a perfect example about the predatory lending. I hate that. And I was blessed. I grew up in a very modest background, but my father told us, you know, that is not the way to borrow money, you know, and he educated us on why. So, but I see so much of it here. I didn't grow up in this state. And so I realized that there is some kind of a lack of education about that matter. So we're in the thought of having a law to limit that never even entered into my mind. And so how do you balance what should be changed at a legal level, and what needs to, how do you raise the education to go, there has to be a better way. So that's a real delicate matter, and I just need more. I guess what you're saying about community, bringing that discussion to the table so that those things come up and people are more aware, and maybe the law is the right thing to do.
So practically speaking, from my own personal perspective, I saw them, I lived in Greenville, Mississippi for 6 years. So I saw them popping up on every corner. And I also, when I did lobby, half of my year was community education. But what brought it to my attention was they were just popping up on every corner, and they were popping up in certain parts of the state, and then in certain neighborhoods in certain parts of the state. So I would take the time and talk to somebody who's coming out of the store and say, hey, what kind of loan is that? Or I really did ask the person what kind of business it was. And they told me that they go in and they pay every two weeks on their loan. And I was like, okay, well, how long does it take you to pay it off? So you get a loan for $300, you pay every 260 every 2 weeks, and you never touch the principal. Those are just fees and interest. So the next question that anybody can ask, if you spot an issue like that, to say, is that legal? That's the first question. And if you have no experience, no exposure with the law, call somebody that does, like Alyssa said, and say you just came across this issue. You want to know if it's legal. You want to know if it's a matter of state law, municipal law. You know, just tell me how it's legal. And then that will let you know that the law is either broken or that you think the law is fine. And then that leads you to connections with people who are working on the issue in the community. When I did it, I was with the Mississippi Center for Justice, a nonprofit law firm here in Jackson. So half of my year, I was actually out, after I learned the system, learned the law, I was actually out in the neighborhoods educating people who were using the loans about the predatory and abusive nature of the loans and offering them alternatives. The rest of the time was spent at the state capitol trying to get them to reform the law. So,
Great. All right, we've got time probably for one, maybe two more questions. Kristen.
So, Judge Reeves, he was presiding over this nationally high-profile case this spring, right? And the Religious Freedom Act, and his opinion that came down against it. And my, I don't have a law background, but I'm thinking since you clerked for him, I'm assuming that as clerks, that was, I wonder what that was like. I'm assuming that you must have been part of that process of putting together a 60-page opinion in time before that law could come into effect. Is that true? I mean, were you part of that, or did you have a ton of clerks and you didn't work on that particular opinion?
So I know there are certain restrictions about how much y'all can go into that ongoing litigation, but can you speak in a general sort of way to anything that Kristen's asked about the process of what chambers looks like? And maybe I should just ask in an open-ended way, what can you say in response to the question?
One thing that we can say is that everyone in the chambers works on the opinions when they're at large.
Yeah, I guess aside from that, we can't, because as you may know, that ruling was appealed to the Fifth Circuit and is currently pending. And so it's very much an open and active case. And just as clerks and as part of it, it's its own, we're just limited, I guess, into more specifics.
Sorry. Well, you know, what this means is we've got to get them back in a year or two when everything is settled, and then we can hear whatever they feel like they can say at that point. All right, we probably have time for one more question. Here we go.
Yes, going back to my labor in prisons, I kind of see that there's kind of a conflict between the Eighth Amendment and the 13th Amendment, because in my personal view that free labor does seem like a cruel and unusual punishment. So I'm thinking that possibly in the future, a case go to the Supreme Court to prevent state laws and state prisons in the states and in the federal prison system from doing such a thing on an Eighth Amendment basis.
I think that you're right in that there is a bit of a conflict there. And I think that the 13th Amendment and the clause we talked about remains, I would say, relatively untested comparatively to, you know, the 14th Amendment, the First Amendment, the Fourth Amendment, the Sixth Amendment. I mean, so I do think that that's something that hopefully, you know, is looked at and is challenged. And I think that as we continue, as I think both Alicia and I talked about, to revisit the Eighth Amendment, I know Alicia's the definition of cruel, right? And in terms of judicially and as a society, how we look at that, will that be an opportunity to maybe correct where maybe the 13th Amendment fell a little bit short?
And I just want to clarify one point that I made about the pay of prisoners. Alyssa and I were talking earlier, and while we both agree that in free society we have a choice whether we work or not, unless you're independently wealthy, I don't see why you would exercise your right not to work, but we do have that right. And I'm not saying that prisoners have a right not to work, to do certain types of jobs. I mean, we all have to get up, we have to maintain our living space. Those things prisoners should do while they're incarcerated. But in terms of a prison contracting with a multi-million dollar company to hire those prisoners and to force a prisoner to contract himself out for 20 cents on the dollar to make Gucci rich, that's the problem with the prison slavery that I have. Because that is the same thing that happened to newly free African Americans under the 13th Amendment. You may have been a vagrant, for example. You're now free. Some people did put the slaves off the plantation, no homes, nowhere to go, no property. So they created vagrancy laws to put you at parchment, which was another form of slavery. So in terms of skill sets, sharpening up skill sets or introducing prisoners to work, I have no problems with that. I believe that that's necessary, and I believe that that's part of the rehabilitation. But when it is about benefiting the private industry, I think that prisoners should be paid a fair wage for their labor.
Great. Well, I think that we're out of time. I'm guessing that if anybody has any really pressing questions that you didn't get a chance to ask, that maybe you can snag Alyssa or Alicia before they walk out. But I know they also need to get on about their lives. So let's thank them for spending this time. Great. Thanks so much to you both. I hope you find your way back to Millsaps sometime soon. And look forward to seeing, I hope, most of you next Friday, same time, same place. Have a good weekend.